Krishnan, now aviation expert, joins in to talk about that. We also have Dheeraj Mathur from PwC to give us his comments. Mr. Krishnan, first I want to come to you on the premium valuations that this deal has gotten struck at, and what your initial thoughts are.
Perhaps Etihad feels there's a lot of value to investing in Jet Airways. Otherwise, this kind of
Yes, please go ahead.
I think Etihad feels there's a lot of value for investment in Jet Airways. Mm. Otherwise, they wouldn't have given this kind of this kind of investment for what you have right now in the market space. So I think it's a good premium they have given because they see value in this particular deal. That's how I look at it.
Okay. Do you see this open the doors for many more, foreign aviation players come into our markets? Because talks have been on with other players as well.
Yeah, you see, the point is, it all depends on how mature your domestic player, each of the domestic player is. For instance, if you look at Jet Airways, they are very mature. They have a long, in fact, their contribution from international operations is more than what they get from domestic generated revenues. Mm. But it is not so of other airlines. So, but in any case, the whole idea of FDI in aviation, including allowing investment from foreign carriers, was to deepen and widen the presence of domestic carriers. It cannot be seen as a deal which only helps you to extend your international, your forays. It should actually help you in consolidating the position in the domestic situation. If that going to happen is what one needs to look at it very, very seriously.
Okay. Also, I just wanted your thoughts on what this would do for the sector itself in the Indian markets, because a lot of players have, vehemently opposed this particular deal, stating that it could lead to a monopoly by a foreign player, it could lead to aggression in terms of pricing, etc. How do you see Etihad coming on board, changing the game for the entire sector?
No, the point is, what you are referring to is the news item which appeared in a couple of days back. Mm. That actually relates to the bilateral entitlements. Mm. What you have today for Etihad or Abu Dhabi as part of India-UAE deal, as you have with Dubai also, is about 13,300 seats a week. That's what Etihad gets. Mm. But what the JET has written to the Ministry of Civil Aviation is, they need to have 400% more, nearly 40,000 seats more, okay, which would take Etihad to about 55,000 seats, virtually equal to what Dubai has got. Mm. So Dubai right now has nearly 195 flight frequencies each week. So that may happen with Etihad also. As it is, if look at Emirates of Dubai, has got 13.04% market share. Mm. You may have Etihad also doing it. And these two, for instance, Dubai and Abu Dhabi, are hardly 2 hours away, in terms of a car drive. Mm. And they are going to be the two hubs. It is going to definitely impact the hubs in India. Either Delhi or Bombay will no longer be hubs. You will not be able to get that kind of return. And thirdly, most importantly, if the government has decided, has approved, and has already started investing, 30,000 crores, that comes to, when it is 45 rupees to a dollar when it was, mm, it was nearly $7 billion to rescue Air India over a period of 9 years. Now, why do you invest $7 billion in Air India when not a penny is going to come back to you? So I don't think it could happen that way. It's a deal between Etihad and Jet Airways, standalone deal, which is going to help you domestically. Yes, one has to welcome it. Secondly, if it is going to provide some kind of support to Etihad in terms of Jet providing passengers from India, that is fine. But just to ensure that it should become another Emirates kind of things, it will destroy India's aviation comprehensively. That's my view. I'm sure they are very legitimate about it. When a civil aviation ministry asked Air India, mm, they said it's about 2,400 seats can be given extra a week. Mm. Even Spice and Indigo did not say more than 3,000, 4,000. To ask them for 55,000 seats, you're going to make the same mistake as you made with Emirates. It's a good airline. It doesn't cast any aspersion on the quality of the airline.
Okay,
the
Mr. Krishnan,
Indian aviation.
Sure. Because you track the space so closely, can you list down for us what the top three or four positives are for Jet Airways now that Etihad comes on board?
You see, if Etihad comes on board for Jet Airways, mm-hmm, one is in terms of financial backup, they're going to give. They're, mm-hmm, people with very, very deep pockets, number, mm-hmm, one. They can even start going to international market for borrowing. They can certainly get some kind of financial help from Jet Airways over and above these things, mm, which need not be investment in terms of equity. Mm. Secondly, they can certainly provide them technical help, which they have in Abu Dhabi, which is hardly 3.5 hours flight from here. And there are more in terms of packaging and producing an international product. I think for whatever reason, though Etihad is hardly 6 years old, but then they have been able to do things in different ways. So that will help. And apart, so that's what I said, engineering support, you have the financial support, you have a product support, and as far as ground handling is concerned, I'm told Jet has already entered into a dialogue or an agreement with Danata, which is Dubai based but does provide ground handling in Abu Dhabi also, and also in Dubai, and perhaps they may do it in Sharjah also. That will be something which will be an add-on to Jet Airways. They can get that kind of facilities here. For instance, if Jet Airways now wants to get into ground handling with Danata, they can make a formal application in India and get into that also. So in terms of that, it's a good deal, but only thing is one should not go overboard in terms of bilateral. There are two different things. It's the sovereign nation which decide who should deal with whom. It can't be dictated by airlines. After all, this kind of request was not there when the deal was talked about in January. How come suddenly it comes in? So I don't think you can sweeten the deal this way and destroy all others. That should not happen.
Sure. Mr. Krishnan, I wanted to ask you about the whole bilateral agreement issue, you know, because there was so much talk about the fact that the bilateral rights between India and UAE that Jet Etihad will strike may hurt not just other players but the industry as a whole. What is your view on that issue and the impact it may have on the industry?
See, it will certainly hurt if you look at the, if you take, you know, out of 100% of Indians flying out of India, as I told you, Emirates already has about 13% market share. Now, if you're going to give a similar kind of, bilateral entitlements to Etihad, then most of them, what do they do? After it's a sixth freedom, they pick up passengers from India, take them to their home hub in, say, either Dubai or Abu Dhabi in this case, and then fly out to various places, whether it is east, west, whichever way they fly out. So very soon, you may have a situation where even Etihad can go up to 10 or 12%. So if you find only these two carriers from Dubai and from Abu Dhabi, these two carriers from India take away 25 to 27% of outbound passengers from India, it's a huge thing. And let me tell you one thing, it will not only impact Air India, definitely Air India will be finished, but it will impact European carriers also, mega carriers also. So they will ask for more bilateral entitlement, number one. There is the pressure from Lufthansa that we should be allowed to bring in our A380, which we have not been allowing. Thirdly, let me tell you, most importantly, watch out for two more airlines. Qatar will feel completely missed out of India. They have been asking, they have been looking for partners here. So you may have a Qatar which may tie up with one of the existing partners, number one. And similarly, Singapore Airlines can also do it. After all, you must know one thing. We got into the observer status in APAC with the help of Singapore government a few years ago. That's a, you know, it's a sort of more to do with foreign relations. Now, if Singapore also asks for it, because Air Asia is giving them competition. So what happens in India is, you have an Emirates from Dubai, you have an Etihad from Abu Dhabi, then you'll have Qatar, then you'll have Singapore, all of them will ask for same seat entitlements. Because you cannot say no. After it has to be justified, why have you given it to these guys? Why not to others? In the case of Emirates, it was given independent Emirates. In this case, it is along with Etihad, the same thing will happen. So at this rate, you will find that these four or five airlines, 3 years down the line, you will find 85 to 90% of passengers from India will all be taken by them. What is left of Air India will be nothing. I think government is wasting money on Air India, spending 30,000 crores over 6 years. They will have to close it down. It is better to save money than sink more money and then suffer again. And the same thing will happen to other private carriers also.
Okay, Mr. Krishnan, thanks so much for joining us and giving us that update. That's the word.